everybody. I'd like to start by welcoming you all here today to the offices of the Henry Jackson Society. My name's Tom Wilson. I'm the resident associate fellow at the Centre for the New Middle East here at the Society. And we're very honoured to be joined by Dr. Liam Fox today for our event on Iran. Dr. Fox is, of course, the former Secretary of State for Defence and Member of Parliament for North Somerset, as well as being the author of the much acclaimed book, Rising Tides, Facing the Challenges of a New Era. And we're particularly grateful to Dr. Fox for taking time out of his busy schedule to come and speak to us about this issue at this critical time. The Iranian nuclear threat and indeed Iranian influence throughout the region is an issue that we give particular priority to here at the Henry Jackson Society. The way the proceedings are going to work this afternoon is I will raise a number of points relating to the Iranian nuclear agreement. Dr. Fox will be able to respond to those, and then we'll move to question and answers from the audience. So perhaps I could begin by asking about your initial thoughts on the agreement, and do you believe that this agreement does have adequate provisions to meet its objectives? Barack Obama suggested that there wasn't a better deal possible. Do you agree with that proposition?
Well, first of all, I would like there to be a deal that could be reached that would limit Iranian nuclear ambitions, because Iran abandoning genuinely its ambitions to have nuclear weapons would be a plus for the region, it would be a plus globally, because Iran in search of a nuclear weapon will be the trigger for a destabilizing arms race in the region. So there is a very big prize here. Now, if I were to get out of bed on the right side of the bed and take the optimistic view and say maybe there will be genuine change in the regime by the time the 10-year envelope is gone, but maybe it won't. And maybe in 10 years they will have decided that they don't want, with the extra money they will have and a 1 year to break out, to thumb their nose at the international community, and maybe it will all work out on the optimistic side of expectations, maybe. Maybe they'll be completely honest and transparent with us and not try to pull a fast one over the next 10 years. Maybe we will see them accepting their own religious strictures, that the development of a nuclear weapon would be religiously unacceptable. Maybe there will be free and open access. Maybe they won't use their money to fund proxies in the region in the way that they have in the past, and maybe they won't try to manipulate the terms of the treaty. But there are an awful lot of maybes. And, you know, for so many maybes to fall on the right side of the toss of a coin is quite a big risk to be taking. It's not to say that there aren't potential big gains of getting Iran back into the community of family of nations, if you like, of responsible ones, and of course, economically, getting Iran to be increasing its oil and gas production won't be necessarily a bad thing in depressing global prices or counterbalancing Russia from a strategic point of view. But really, we're running, in my view, an awfully big risk for some potential prizes. And I think that, above all else, it would be nice to be dealing with a partner whose previous behaviour had earned our trust. And that is the one thing I'm absolutely sure of, is Iran has not earned our trust. And so for me, to go back to your very first question, before we saw the agreement, for me the question was, will this be unfettered and unrestricted access? And it's not quite unfettered and unrestricted. And therein, I think, lies the risk.
Thank you. Defenders of the deal have accused its critics by saying that they have not come up with a viable alternative to this deal, and that indeed the alternative would be war. Do you think there was an alternative to the approach taken by the P5+1 countries? And regarding the war allegation, do you think there ever was a viable military option? Do you think there still is a viable military option?
Well, there are always military options. Whether they're viable or not is another matter. Whether they might be successful is yet another matter. The alternative was the maintenance of sanctions. The alternative was not a war, it was to maintain the sanctions on the regime. The regime came to the negotiating table because the sanctions were hurting them. I thought all along when we got to the April agreement that they should maintain sanctions, full sanctions then, because the sanctions were about bringing them to the table to begin a negotiation, not about ending them too quickly. And I guess, I think this argument that it was either an agreement almost at any price or war was an utterly false choice placed before us. We could have maintained the sanctions. I think there was more than a little incentive driving the process in the White House that there needs to be an Obama legacy in the region. And I think this was a large part of the calculation. It may turn out to be a good legacy. As I say, these are very big gambles, but it wasn't the only course available.
Of course, the agreement will gradually lift sanctions and also pretty much upfront unfreeze large amounts of Iranian assets. We always expected that to be the case, but something that came on the agenda quite late, something that wasn't in the April agreement, was this issue of the arms embargo being lifted, and also the issue of the with to do with ballistic missiles technology. Assuming that these are going to be lifted 5 years and then 8 years regarding the ballistic missiles, it's been suggested that these weapons will likely find their way to Assad, to other Iranian proxies in the region. What do you think could be the repercussions for the security and stability of the region and also for British interests there as well?
Well, I've always seen it as being two issues. One about Iran's nuclear ambitions and the scale of the problem that would cause us were they to ever come to fruition. The second is Iran's general behavior in the region, being willing to use proxies as a tool of foreign policy. We've seen the price that we paid Britain in Afghanistan, for example, because of Iranian involvement in weapons being provided to our enemies. Why we would want to see a lifting of the arms embargo, which can only exacerbate that. I mean, they're not going to, even if they were to change their behavior on nuclear policy, which I think is delayed rather than changed, but they're not going to change their behavior in terms of funding and assisting Hezbollah or Hamas. That, it seems to me, to be making a rod for our own back in terms of medium-term policy, maybe not even medium-term, and in terms of nuclear, in terms of missile technology, why would you want to even think about giving someone the capability of a delivery system when they say there's nothing that they want to deliver with it?
Staying with the implications for the region, obviously we have some significant allies in the Middle East who are very nervous about this agreement. I'm thinking, of course, of Israel and also of some of the Gulf states. There has been the suggestion of various reactions from these countries in the case of the Gulf states, perhaps something relating to nuclear proliferation there. But do you think, in terms of response from other regional powers, that escalation in the region is something we should be worried about as a response to this agreement?
You mean in the otherwise quiet world of the Middle East, where ISIS are not already exacerbating the problems that we have, that they might destabilize this peaceful and stable region? I mean, let me tell you what will happen. Obama will get his way and Congress will not be able to block him. There'll be a bit of noise from some of our Arab partners in the region, but not very much else. They'll still be looking at ISIS. America will still be carrying the burden of the battle against ISIS. When we say that we are second only to America in number of airstrikes, I don't know if you're aware of the numbers, it's 92% the United States, 4% the United Kingdom, 4% everyone else put together. Yeah, not much of a league table. And I think that they will continue to make a lot of noises in public, and some of our European partners will continue to make skeptical noises while they're on the plane with the contracts to Tehran. That's how it's going to play out.
And regarding the question of British interests and how that relates to this agreement, you mentioned, of course, the issue of Iranian influence with weapons being supplied in Afghanistan, for instance. There were, of course, many people who believed that it was Iranian-made IEDs that were blowing up British soldiers in Iraq and Afghanistan. We just recently, during some of the demonstrations in Tehran, we saw the British flag being burnt alongside the American and the Israeli one. We had the storming of the British embassy in 2011, and of course the capture of British naval personnel by Iran in 2007. That's a lot of hostility towards Britain there coming from that regime. What do you think Britain's policy in general should be towards Iran?
Well, a very good beginning for foreign policy and certainly for security policy is rational analysis, not wishful thinking. Wishful thinking is a dangerous foreign policy. It's a potentially catastrophic security policy. And I don't know if anyone missed Khamenei himself saying, they're not our friends. Effectively, we might have done a deal with them, but they're not our friends. They are 180 degrees, he said, different in from us. This is not a regime that's going to be cuddling up to us anytime soon. And Khamenei is one of the most consistent politicians. I mean, most Western politicians would give their eye teeth to be as consistent as he is. There's a wonderful little book called Reading Khamenei by Karim Sanjipur from the Carnegie Endowment in the States. And it's just analyzes his writings, his speeches, and it's very clear that he is ultra consistent in his fear of contamination culturally of the Iranian Revolution, his utter contempt for the United States, and his hatred for the existence of the State of Israel. He doesn't make it hidden in any way, shape, or form. And all those who think that Rouhani, because he's a bit more Western friendly and went to a university in Glasgow, really need to think really hard about who calls the shots in Tehran. And even his speech yesterday or the day before about how he accepted the deal made it also very, very clear what he thought in terms of his country's relationship with the West. So even if you were on the optimistic side of this and you thought, well, maybe he'll give his support, which he seems to have given at least tacitly to the nuclear agreement, it is not going to change how Iran behaves in the region. They haven't promised to. They haven't even hinted at it. We haven't even asked it of them. They will behave similarly because that is how they follow their regional policies and influence. So I don't see why we would expect there to be a change as a result of this agreement when many of the constraining elements on that behaviour are being lifted. One other thing I wanted to say on that was that there's been this view in a lot of European capitals that it wouldn't actually make a difference on freezing 150 billion of Iranian assets because they were able to fund and promote their proxies in the region even when sanctions were in place. Therefore, sanctions don't really have much effect on this. Now, it may be true that there's a great deal of money will be sucked into Iran because of investments that have gone unmade for a very long time. That may be true. But I just find it rather difficult to believe that none of the unfrozen money will find its way to Iran's proxies in the region or their military supplies. I find that, again, it well into the territory of wishful thinking.
No, I was just thinking about the what are some of Britain's national interests might be within the region, and a region in which Iran is emboldened. Even during the negotiation period, we saw some sort of gentle harassment, to put it mildly, of shipping through the Straits of Hormuz, and Tehran has often threatened that. It's interesting that Philip Hammond, of course, went to visit Israel shortly after the agreement was released, and I wonder whether there is a concern that some of our traditional allies in the region, whether some relationships will be strained there off the back of that agreement. Are you concerned about Britain's relationships there?
I'm concerned with the apparent lack of willingness of some of our allies in the region to lift a finger against ISIS at the present time. That's my bigger, more immediate worry. This is a problem of their region that didn't appear overnight. We've already seen the phenomenon that we see so often, which is we don't want American influence in the region until the flames start appearing, and then they say, where are the American firefighters? And so you've got, again, America doing the heavy lifting when it comes to what's happening with ISIS at the moment. At some point, the countries in the region need to understand that their security is largely their business and that we cannot always be there to help out. Yes, we've got regional influence, we've got our navy in Bahrain and so on, but there needs at some point to be a realization that countries need to come up front when it comes to their own defense. And I hope that when Philip's been there, he's been doing some tough talking in a number of capitals, because it's all very well to say, oh, there's increased Iranian influence here, and this may help, destabilize the region further. Well, hang on a minute. This is not our region.
Regarding the British role in the negotiations, in the diplomatic tracking within P5+1, it seemed, just observing from the outside, as though certain other European countries, such as France in particular, made themselves very much heard, were particularly loud on issues such as weapons inspections, and on the issue of the lifting of the arms embargo. It seemed at times that France, for instance, was taking a harder position than the Americans were. What kind of role do you feel that Britain played within putting together this agreement? Did we have a distinctive policy in the same way that perhaps France did?
Oh, I think we probably played a very straight role in that. And my worry is that in the aftermath, that we'll still be talking about the agreement itself, while in Paris and Berlin there are contracts being signed with companies in Tehran. And wouldn't exactly be unprecedented that we find ourselves in that position. I have a lot of respect for Philip Hammond, and I think he and his team probably played a very straight role. But I think that, and I know that having spoken to him after what he said in the Commons the other day was that the access question was absolutely key. And the question I think will be how close to the unfettered, unrestricted access that I wanted to see have we ended up being with this rather bizarre committee structure, and how do you get access to this? And when it says you can only get access to the committee that will decide it once the IAEA has decided that a site is suspicious, who determines what that actually means, that term? I've not seen a definition of that. What level of suspicion triggers the action of involving that? There's so much detail here. And I remember saying last time I was in the States, you have to hand it to the Iranians. They are masters of treaty and detail, and they're masters at manipulation of treaty too. So we better have every T crossed and every I dotted and know what all those terms mean, and know what index of suspicion we have to get to trigger some of these processes. And we will find that out as we get a better and more thorough reading of what's going on.
And perhaps I could actually just pick up on that specific within the agreement, because as well as having to go through these series of committees in terms of inspections, particularly for military sites, there's a similar sort of laborious structure in place as far as the so-called snapping back of sanctions is concerned. Barack Obama has often referenced this snapback as being the solution to any flaws we might see in the agreement. Do you think snapback is really possible? Is that going to be achievable quickly?
It's possible. Will all parties involved show the same willpower in implementing it? If from now you get big companies and some of those who are party to the negotiation with increased financial interests, increased commercial interests, will it be the same appetite for a reintroduction of sanctions, which will then cause much more pain than they're doing the present time? We wait to see. The P5+1 are signed up to it. I've seen a lot of things signed up to.
And one last question that I had before moving to the audience was, you did touch on this issue of whether or not the regime would reform, and the Obama administration have made some suggestions that perhaps that would happen, but perhaps it wouldn't, and this deal would still be in place anyway. But I noticed that John Kerry mentioned when the arms embargo was being discussed, he pointed out or claimed that, of course, Iran had a role to play with fighting ISIS, and there have been those who have suggested in some ways that Iran is potentially an ally in the region in fighting groups like ISIS. So what is your take on that expectation?
I've never been a big backer of my enemy's enemy is my friend. I think that's a very dangerous policy to get involved in. When Rouhani became president, there were so many people in the West who were saying this is a great chance, a great opportunity for reform. What reform has there been? They're still stringing up people at a terrifying rate in Tehran. Their abuses of human rights are appalling. The treatment of the Green Movement, and in fact our abandonment of the Green Movement, was in my view the low point of Western political morality of recent times. And if you consider how we abandoned the Green Movement and compare what we did with, take solidarity as an example in the Cold War, how we were willing to give political support, moral support, as well as apply political pressure on the regime, we did achieve a result. The utter abandonment of the Green Movement, without even giving them moral support, I thought was absolutely shameful. And there has not been reform in Iran, and there's not going to be reform in Iran, certainly as long as Khamenei is there. And I'm afraid, unlike a lot of commentators, I think there's no guarantee that his successor would necessarily be more liberal than he is. So, you know, it would be nice to think that the regime can change. Of course, to be fair, you saw with Ayatollah Khomeini's cup of poison moment when they realised that they couldn't get anywhere in the Iran-Iraq war, that there was time for a fundamental shift in policy. Maybe we will see such a fundamental shift. But again, I've said maybe an awful lot of times.
Thank you. I hope that gives a good basis for further questions and that provokes some thoughts from our audience. I think with questions to start with, we can go one at a time, but just one rule: if we ask that people introduce themselves, if you just give your name and an organization you're associated with, perhaps. I'm going to have a show of hands for questions. This gentleman here in the front.
Me, okay. Yes. Well, thank you. Most interesting discussion. My name is Andrew Leung. I'm an independent China strategist. So looking at from the outside, or as it were. How much do you think that there is the elephant in the room, which is the Sunni-Shiite rivalry that informs Iran's behavior? And if we don't deal with that rivalry, if we don't appease, you know, the rivalry between the Sunnis and the Shiites, we are not going to solve the problem one way or the other. So I'd like your comment on that. And also, you refer to the fact that the alternative is not war, but sanctions. Now, how much would the continuance of sanctions would force Iran to give up the nuclear weapons, or would it even hasten Iran towards nuclearization? So, and then you look at this deal. May it not be an alternative by offering Iran a chance to be embedded in the international economic order? Although it's not exactly comparable. I mean, look at China in the old days. By embedding China in the global economic order, it did have some impact on China's behavior. Would not be the same method be useful as far as Iran is concerned, rather than ostracizing it, but bringing it more into the international economic order?
It's not an unreasonable thing to say. I mean, I would point out right at the beginning that bringing Russia into the G8 didn't exactly make Russia a less aggressive or expansionist nation. If anything else, it fed Putin's pretensions. And so, while it's not an unreasonable approach to come from, I don't think that experience suggests that there's anything like a guarantee that economic interdependence with a state that is fundamentally different in outlook is going to produce that behavior. People always give the example, well, you know, Europe became much more economically interdependent, and look how we've had, since World War II, this prolonged period of peace, but we're nations that are broadly similar in outlook, democratic systems, legal systems. It's very different when you're playing with someone who has very different rules. Russia should give us a good example for that. I would suggest that Iran is another one. But there are a lot of words we don't say in this debate. We don't say the words Wahhabist and Salafist very much, which are words that we should be saying when we're talking about the things that are the glowing embers in the region. I remember when I was writing my book, and it was Condi Rice said to me, when it all goes really wrong, it's all going to go really wrong in Syria. She said, you've got religious and secular. You've got Sunni and Shia. You've got a proxy US Russian rivalry. You've got a proxy Iranian Saudi rivalry, and they're all in the same place. And she said, when it goes bang, that's where it goes bang. And you know, not exactly far off the mark. But we've got to be. We use so many terms to try, I think, to not cause offence. But the bottom line is that in that part of the world, it's mostly the fatalities are Muslims killing Muslims because they're the wrong sort of Muslim. And we have to be brutally frank about it, because we're otherwise never going to be able to tell the truth in a way that lets us get to even the lexicon to enable us to get progress.
Thank you. The gentleman at the back, on this side. Still got your hand up, sir. Okay.
Thank you very much indeed. My name's Ewan Grant, a former government intelligence analyst, but not in defence and foreign policy, which is law enforcement. My question is, where do you see our European partners, and maybe that's in quotation marks, playing a role economically and in military, I think particularly air and naval contingencies? On the one hand, you've expressed, I think, very rightly concerns about seduction by contractors. On the other hand, France has to balance its interest because, of course, it has a base in the UAE and it presumably wants to sell more Rafales to the Gulf. So are they pulling their weight, frankly, in all aspects, diplomatic, politically, economically, and militarily? Whether as nation states who are mainly members of NATO and or through the European institutions. Thank you.
Well, they will. I think up till now, maybe I've been a little surprised at how coherent and cohesive their approach has been through the negotiations, and there haven't actually been very public splits about changes in position. Maybe some nuances for those who are watching for them, but quite a degree of consistency. You're absolutely right that they will want to balance their own military interests, such as they are in the region. But I do make that point again. I love that phrase. I've just stolen your phrase from our own seduction by contract. I'll be using that tomorrow. It is a very big danger because the entire snapback, the whole threat of the reimposition of sanctions, I think, becomes much harder for all the participants when their big economic players have got an interest in the game that they don't have at the present time. So I see that as being potentially a bit of a game changer. But of course, were we not to implement the agreement, were there to be breaches, that is, I'm afraid, a green light for others to get on with their own nuclear programs, because you're on the road to proliferation at that point.
Another one from the back on this side.
Nick Bosenkamp, Professor of Health Policy and Geopolitical, and the advisory member of Reform. Liam, it does seem that if you have, I think you called it unfettered and unrestricted access, or similar agreements to the one that's on the table. Is that the case?
Well, I'm not in favour of. I'm in favour if you can get a nuclear deal. You can absolutely not have confidence in one unless you have complete unfettered and unrestricted access. There are other elements of the deal which I said I'm not necessarily happy about. The release of funds and the timescale in which that would happen, the lifting of an arms embargo and the lifting of an embargo on ballistic missile technology. I think Iran hasn't earned our trust in the wider conduct of the region to earn those parts of the agreement. I worry about their breakout. And what I suppose, hand on heart, what I really worry is that they get all their money back, the regime doesn't reform, and in 10 years' time, when the time limit runs up, they say, do you know what? We've got plenty of dosh. we're 1 year away from developing our capability. See what you can do now. And the bottom line is that's the risk we're running in this. Now, you might say, and again, it's not an unreasonable thing to say, you have to take some risks for peace. The question is how you quantify the risks and whether you think the partner you're involved with has earned sufficient trust for you to be willing to take those risks.
Is the gentleman here?
Thank you. My name is Mehrdad Ponsari. I'm an Iranian political activist. I have been in opposition to this regime for a very long time, but I see this agreement as a positive thing. And what I was hoping you might explain is what would be your alternative to this agreement? Because in the absence of this agreement, the situation is not going to disappear. The threat from Iran is not going to disappear. And in my view, there has been change in Iran, although not in a meaningful way, not in a tangible way, but I would say 70% of people within the ruling establishment, as a consequence of their own experiences, have changed, but they don't make the decisions. You said Khamenei has remained consistent. Khamenei has remained inconsistent in a very key way. He doesn't stand where he stood when he supported Ahmadinejad in the 2009 elections. He doesn't stand in the positions that Ahmadinejad took vis-a-vis these important discussions. So, and you know, you talk about, for example, the Prime Minister said a few days ago that this agreement has nothing to do with other issues between Iran and the West. Well, if it doesn't have anything to do with the other issues, you can't expect Iran to forego its own perceived national interest. Now, I believe Iran does have legitimate rights in the region. For example, they don't have to give missiles to Hezbollah, but they can support them by building hospitals, etc., in a change of behavior. But they are interested, they are legitimate interest as far as Iran is concerned. So you have to look at it this way. You say, for example, that 92% of the air raids is conducted by the United States. And what is the Arab share with all the air force that they have and so on and so forth? And Iran, which is the perceived enemy, is at least engaged against ISIS in a meaningful way in Iraq. So when you put these things together, and you have the right to be skeptical, as everybody does, but is it not a positive thing that this has occurred? Will the people in Iran not become more empowered in terms of playing a bigger role as time comes by? Have you given that some consideration?
What struck me when I was in last in Tehran, which was a few years ago, maybe about 6-7 years ago now, was how westernized looking the young people were. And the fact that you have a population structure the way it is tends to suggest that over time you will get change. And that's, I guess, what those who take the optimistic view are banking on. The question is over what time scale that actually occurs and when you get genuine movement. I also think that there's something bizarre in Western politicians looking at the internet, for example, and saying this is a terrible threat to us because of what jihadists can do and propagate online. You know, actually, it's a great opportunity, as the Prime Minister was saying today, for us to propagate our values much better than we have and to use it as an information war in a way that we haven't been doing up till now. We seem to have forgotten from the Cold War the value of propaganda and of information in what is an ideological struggle. So Iran may change. My worry is, even if you took that argument, what does this time frame of this agreement mean? And is it too optimistic about the rate of change? Because we've always been too optimistic up to this point about the rate of change. So I can't answer that question. And it is a gamble. It might be a gamble being taken for the best motives, but it's a gamble.
What would be your alternative?
As I said, the alternative was the maintenance of sanctions, and to see if further concessions could be got from the regime. Would it be willing to deal with the nuclear program without dealing with the conventional weapons and without dealing with missile technology, for example? But we'll never know now the answer to that question.
I'm the gentleman just here.
David Stoller, private citizen, retired teacher. I think I heard you say that you didn't think Congress would be able to stop this from going forward. Could you say more about that?
Yes, I think the president. I think he ultimately will prevail, and I think he'll get his way. I think Congress will make a lot of noise. I just don't think they'll be able to do it. We were discussing earlier the technical ability of that Congress might impose sanctions, but it's up to the president to enforce them. And if he decides that there's a non-enforcement policy, that's it. And that's his domain. And that's where I think we may be heading.
I think there's a lady with a question here.
My name is Sarah Rose, and I'm interested in an alternative, which is supporting the Iranian opposition in exile. With sanctions in place and the situation in Iran at the moment, there's a very good chance that they could be unseated if the opposition was supported. I've got a book here by Struan Stevenson, an MEP who was president of the European Parliament's delegation for relations with Iraq. And people like that are supporting this proposal. A lot of people supporting this. And given a chance, it could work. And I think that's a chance that we need to take. The vice president, the previous vice president of the European Parliament, he was deselected in Spain because of pressure from Iran. That is the kind of thing Iran does. This needs to be looked at.
I think we should be supporting the reform movement in Iran for a number of reasons. Number one, it's the right thing to do. And I do wish we'd get away from some of the rhetoric we have in this country of, they have a different set of values, and we have a different set of values. In my view, we have a better set of values. What we stand for in terms of our concepts of rights and law and democracy are better than the alternatives. They're not just different, because they provide people with a better way of life in the longer term. But one of my worries about our abandonment of the Green Movement is that supposing there is a change, supposing there is a different sort of government, what have they got to thank us for? You know, they may well be a change, and they'll say, you had an opportunity to help us when we had our colleagues being shot on the streets. What noise did you make? You know, when did you stand up and back us? So I agree, we do need to be more vocal at giving voice to some of these concerns. And people will say, if you stand up for them, it makes them all the more vulnerable and they'll be all the more repressed. Well, how much more repressed are they going to get? And we didn't think that in the battle against communism. So when it's a battle of ideologies, you go into battle with wearing your values on your sleeve. That's how we do it. And that's how in the longer term you win friends with those who, in my view, with the ultimate triumph of liberal democracy, are going to be your colleagues.
I'll take the question from the gentleman here.
Yes. I've been reading a book, and I can't remember the author, but he's an ex-State Department chap, on the next 10 years and the next 100 years of American policy. And it seems to indicate that they can see that Europe is basically not going to be their favorite customer anymore and trading partner because of the very poor financial management that's been going on in Europe. And they see very much that from the United States perspective, that Iran and Turkey, with 70 million population each, they've got to break through these barriers from their perspective and get them as very important markets for the kind of products the United States makes. And it's probably that cynical, unfortunately.
Well, I think that I've had this argument already with someone today. You know, I think that our model, and I think we should be standing up and saying, do you know what? It's actually better to educate girls than not educate girls and give women equal rights. It's better to have religious tolerance than not have religious tolerance. It's better to have a free market than not have a free market. It's better to have a democracy than not have a democracy. It's better to have a rule of law that applies equally to the governing and the governed. I mean, where are we? We should be standing up and making these arguments, because getting these countries to reform in that direction, I happen to think that the most optimistic thing that's happened in the world in 2015 was the Turkish election. It gave me real hope that genuine change could come through. And we'll not get into this argument now, but I mean, one of the reasons that I'm very sceptical about the whole European Union's future is that in a world where we do need to look more outside, and that's what I've written in my book, we have to look at new global partners. In fact, the change in the world around us enables us to have closer workings with countries that are not necessarily geographical in proximity. And if the 20th century was the century of the bloc, we are liberated in the 21st century. As I said, if Fukuyama had called his book The End of Geography, not The End of History, he'd probably been a lot closer to the mark. And we have an opportunity now to actually work much more closely with countries who are like us. But the first thing is to find them, and when they're not like us, help them become like us. I'm not somebody who apologised and said, you know, why should we say our values are any better than anyone else's? Because we are who we are because of the decisions we've made and the consequences of those decisions, so we should be proud of them. And it'd be great. I'd love to see Iran become a pluralistic democracy. I think Turkey has actually shown that it can make the right decisions. There are others out there. We should be influencing countries to develop in that way as best we can, rather than spending the entire time of increasing parts of Whitehall gazing at Europe's navel at a time when it's increasingly economically a basket case, and it's difficult to see how much of Europe can actually escape from the debt trap that it's got itself into. And as Mrs. Merkel says, and you only have to repeat that one stat to know where it is, 7% of the global population, 25% of global GDP, and 50% of global social spending. You tell me how you get out of that anytime soon. And of course, it's natural America will want to look to other partners. Incidentally, if we are half sensible, so will we.
And there was a question just here.
I'm Jenny Carter. I'm also a private citizen and retired teacher. And referring to every single one of the values that you've just expressed, there is the National Council of Resistance of Iran actually has a 10-point plan which encompasses all the things you've just said. It's led by a woman, Maryam Mojaby. Last Thursday, I was at the Houses of Parliament attending a parliamentary committee meeting for Iran freedom. Struan Stevenson actually was speaking at that meeting. And there are many, many influential people in this country, parliamentarians, much support for the NCRI. However, our government has banned Maryam Mojaby, the leader of the NCRI, from coming here. Why? This is an alternative to what we have. They have a very well-structured parliament in exile representing 500 different opposition groups in Iran, religions, ethnic groups, gender equality. Surely this is something we should be giving our backing to. Why are we quiet on this? Why do people not know about it?
Well, we had a debate in Parliament a couple of weeks ago, and it was very well subscribed, and the views that you mentioned were loud and clear there. We do need to hear more. We need to hear more. And I don't know if you heard the Prime Minister's speech today, actually saying, you know, we've actually got to have a values argument now. You can't displace one bad ideology simply with negative arguments. You have to replace it with your own, which I think is exactly where we need to be in this debate.
Is putting forward these values, who
win? I don't know the details of an individual case, therefore I wouldn't want to comment on them. But I'll tell you one group that really do surprise me in this country in not speaking out, and that's our journalists. Because the one group in Iran who are treated appallingly are journalists, and yet our own journalists in this country seem to forget to make the case, or at least too few of them are willing to stand up and make the case about what is one of the worst examples of repression of the media anywhere that I think we see on a regular basis.
Absolutely.
Would you be okay if we started taking questions in groups of three, perhaps, now?
Sure.
So here, and then the gentleman there.
Okay. Marisol, it's private. On July 15, President Obama gave a press conference to the global press for over an hour. He said that we should ignore the rhetoric coming out of Iran and just look at what they may do in the future. I immediately thought, well, wait a minute, does that mean that if we want to encourage physical, sexual, and all sorts of other abuse because we, on the same basis, ignore the rhetoric of what these abusers say, is that the correct corollary? Or somehow are we giving Iran a special case to say what they want because abuse doesn't start with language, it starts somehow with action? Because that's what President Obama said.
Yep. My name is Nicholas Hurley. I'm a new member of the Henry Jackson Society, and it's a pleasure to be here. My main question is about the future, but first I'm going to ask you why you think that the agreement was struck in such a way that past and present issues of concern have not been at the forefront of the agreement, but rather have been put to one side. I doubt the British public would agree with the situation. It's not the Good Friday Agreement. I doubt the public would agree with the situation as it stands today, where there are major issues that have not yet been dealt with and that have now gone onto the carpet while sanctions have been lifted. My main question is about the future of the region. It's impossible to tell whether or not the territorial integrity of Iraq and Syria will be able to remain as it stands today, especially given the emergence of the caliphate. It's my contention, I'd like to ask you, Dr. Fox, if you agree with this, that the relationship that the UK and her allies have with the Kurdish people is going to become critically important to our interests in the region in the next 15 years. Do you agree? And what scope do you think there is for providing far more support than we currently do to the Kurds, particularly in Syria and Iraq?
Mm-hmm. From Turkey Institute. My question is about Turkey. How would this agreement affect Turkey's role? Because Turkey is a country once was being presented as a kind of model country for the Middle Eastern countries. Actually, there is a discussion, particularly in Turkey, they say in the long term, Iran is replacing Turkey's role as a Western alliance. Do you agree with what you're saying?
Oh boy. first of all, Turkey. My view on Turkey is that the European Union's strategic attitude towards Turkey is something that we're already paying a price for and could pay a higher price for in the future. To ostracize and alienate Turkey makes absolutely no sense when it is a key ally in a whole range of issues, not least on issues like Russia and its importance in the security of the South Caucasus, its proximity to Iran, the issues of energy security, and the fact that an increasing number of people in Turkey are not interested in joining the European Union because we think, first of all, they don't want us, and B, it doesn't look as good as it did before in actually getting there, even if you can make it. So I think Turkey is a very, very key ally. I spend quite a lot of time there, and in fact, my book, the first language it came out in after English was Turkish. And I think I think British politicians need to spend a lot more time. They're saying, do you know what? We really value you as an ally. We understand how important you were in the Cold War, and we understand how important you are now. And if we can help Turkey develop as a much more liberal democracy, so much the better. It's an absolute win-win for us. So I see it as crucially important. It is different when you see the region, however, from Turkey, from when you see it from London. And what we call the refugee problem. We say, Turkey should be doing more with the refugee problem. When you've got a million people flooding over your border, that is not a problem. You know, that's a crisis. And I think that we need to be sometimes a bit more understanding with where Turkey is coming from. in some of this issue. The question of what does the future of the region look like? Oh, Lord. And so I'll choose to give you the lottery numbers first, if you'll let me. Yes, I agree. It is. I think the questions of territorial integrity are enormous. Whether Iraq can maintain its existence as a unitary state or Syria. I mean, given where they came from, the fact that they didn't wouldn't be that surprising. And we may have less influence anyway in that than we probably like to think that we have. And when we're talking about, you know, the region, and we're talking today about dealing with ISIS and whether we should have further military intervention, and then your General Richards yesterday saying we should put boots on the ground in the region, that's the only way we'll get stability. I took a very simple view as Defence Secretary, which was there are four questions to answer if you want to do that, which is, number one, what does a good outcome look like? You can't define a good outcome, forget it. Number two, even if you can define it, can you achieve it? Number three, even if you can define it and you can achieve it, do we have to be part of such an outcome? And even if you can answer all three of those, how much of the outcome do you want to own in the future? So we're very keen at dashing in without necessarily thinking through all four bits of those questions. And it's been the downfall of our foreign and security policy for a very long time, in that we must do something mode before we think through what it is exactly we want to do and what we can do. So I don't know what the answer is, and I don't know whether the disintegration of Iraq and Syria will provide us with political opportunities and risks. And the first question, I don't think we should ever judge any politician by rhetoric. let's judge a government by what they do. So when you say, presumably if an American president says, never mind the rhetoric of Iran, it's all right for Iran to say, never mind the rhetoric of America, it's equally unimportant. Tehran and the regime should be judged by the actions that they have taken in the past. And as I said, the key thing for me on that is they have not earned our trust. They built their nuclear facilities in secret, in contradiction of, at the very least, the spirit of NPT. At Parchin, when they were suspected of having a facility to test triggers for nuclear weapons, it is completely in violation of every promise that they ever gave. They have not earned the ability to be trusted, which is why I go back to say, it's all, you must have absolutely robust verification procedures. So would I trust them on their rhetoric? Absolutely not. Would I ignore their rhetoric? Absolutely not. Because it gives you a pretty good indication of how the regime really thinks and what it really thinks about the West.
We're going to take another three questions. Here, and also the one at the very back there.
David Behrens, JNF UK. Dr. Fox, you touched on what you think will happen in Congress. Do you think there should actually be a campaign to try to get the faithless Democrats to actually vote against the deal? And if that does fail, do you think that if there is a change in party control of the White House, that it is a wise thing for that person to actually reimpose sanctions and to try to unravel the deal? Do you think that would be a prudent thing to do?
Mr. Fox, it seems that you mentioned the 10 years that we've got for the deal before the deal comes to an end. But can there be any confidence that the deal will ever go anything like for 10 years? The Iranian spokesman already said yesterday, it's not about us keeping our word, it's about the Americans keeping their word, which to me indicates they are going, once they've got the money, and the money's in the bank, and they don't need us anymore, they can then turn around and say, the Americans aren't doing what they're supposed to do, we're pulling out. So as far as that's concerned, that's a concern for me. I think it'd be a miracle if it's 10 years before that happens. And the other thing which you said is that we singularly didn't help the Greens in Iran, and that was a bad mistake, and we should have done that. Do you not think that having this, I mean, when you see the Iranian now dancing in the street and laughing and cheering and saying, we did a fantastic deal. So being how we are, oppressive and everything else, we did an amazing deal. That is going to ruin the position that the Greens might ever have had, or the opportunity that the Greens might ever have had in order to take the matter forward.
Thank you. And also there was one in the far corner. Yes.
Sanctions that you have repeated a couple of times that we should propose more sanctions is the sanctions were not actually affecting the government. It was the Iranian population that felt the most was the most affected by the sanctions. So what the gentleman just said about his people on the streets were not happy about the sanctions being lifted possibly if the government will abide by the deal. That's just Iranian people being very happy that they will have a chance to participate more in the global economy and to better their lives. But that aside, how do you think that Iran can now, under the current rule, let's assume that they want this to work, how would they be able to prove that they are trustworthy and that we can work with them and actually achieve the goals that were set out in the agreement instead of just focusing on
Well, first of all, I think the sanctions were hurting the regime. I think had they not been hurting the regime would not have come to the negotiating table. Economically, it was doing quite a lot of damage to their prospects of being able to recover economically. I've no doubt that people were genuinely delighted quite how objective the details were of the agreement and how well they were disseminated in throughout the public in Iran would be an interesting piece for someone to write. But it's also important to understand that for a lot of people in Iran, whether they're supporters of the regime or not, this idea that they were able to get access to a civil nuclear program was quite a strong element of national pride. So there was quite a lot tied up in that. For us, we've always accepted that Iran, under NPT, was able to get a civil nuclear program. The question was whether we could trust Iran to have the elements of the civil nuclear program without them going on to try to create a nuclear weapon state. And they've shown us at every opportunity that they couldn't be trusted in that. And Mike, on the trust question, I think it boils down to this. If we really believed that Iran had changed and that they had fundamentally altered their view about ever trying to get a nuclear weapon capability, why stop at 10 years? Why not have a perpetual arrangement that goes all the way into the future? If that's what they want, if that's what they say they want, and if it's what we say that we want, why are we stopping at 10 years? Why are we building this risk into the process that they may not have reformed in that time frame, and that they may be much richer, and that they may be a year from breakout? It seems to me that we're building in risk into that. It seems to fly in the face of some of our own rhetoric in terms of what we've set out. And in terms of what should they do in American politics, well, I've long given up advising anyone in American politics. But as I say, even if Congress were to say we're against the lifting of sanctions and that the president is entitled because he's in charge of their implementation to say, it's not going to happen. By the time we get past the next presidential election, beyond the next inauguration, this process is quite a long way down that road. And I think that's why, at the moment, it will end up being implemented. I think whether or not in the longer term it is the point this gentleman here says that the big risk in unraveling is that if Iran gets a lifting of the arms embargo and a lifting of the missile embargo and it gets the unfreezing of its assets, and it gets its civil nuclear program, it would not be inconceivable, let's put it that way, if they said, we've fulfilled our bit of the bargain, others have not fulfilled theirs, therefore we're released from the bargain. And the question then becomes the credibility of the snapback. And it goes back to the question that was asked earlier. Are we retaining our credibility enough in the Iranians' eyes that they believe we would reimpose sanctions if they broke with the agreement? And that is going to be quite a trick to pull off. And the longer we have to pull it off, and the longer that we're seduced by contracts, the more difficult that we're going to find it to maintain our credibility. And credibility is key to all of this. Takes me back to, since we're finishing, my very starting point, which is maybe I'll be proved wrong, and maybe the regime will change, and it will change in time, and maybe it'll be replaced by a much more pro-Western, liberal, pluralistic one. Maybe when we get past 10 years, they will genuinely have given up their nuclear ambitions. Maybe they'll listen to their own so-called religious strictures, which say it's wrong to develop a nuclear bomb. Maybe they will not be destabilizing the region and not provide a risk in terms of disseminating risk. Maybe. But there are an awful lot of maybes in all of that. And I think that, I still think that if I have a major reservation, it's about verification, and it's about why did we feel that given Iran's involvement in the region, given the difficulties we currently have, that we had to include arms embargo and missile technology embargo as part of the deal over the nuclear system. That seems to me to have bent too far.
That just leaves it to me to thank Dr. Fox for coming. We're hugely grateful that you were able to come at this critical time to talk about this issue. Thank you very much.